Thank you so much. And Andrew, thank you very much. And Dean Rutherford, thank you. It's so good to be here at the Clinton School of Public Service here in Little Rock, and particularly an honor in this time of celebration of the 10th anniversary of the Clinton Center. I only regret that I am a few days late of missing the festivities and the President and Secretary of State. But thank you so much. I'm sorry I brought the weather from Boston with me, but it's worse back home, so I'm happy to be here for that reason, too. I also want to thank the good folks at Regnant Populus and the Arkansas Democracy Coalition who've done so much to bring this issue to folks in Arkansas, and thank you all for what you do. It's the kind of local grassroots phenomenon that I'm actually seeing around the country. The organization of new groups that aren't national or that are really just citizens in different places coming together to say, what can we do about the state of our democracy? What can we do? No longer thinking, there'll be a nice, easy answer or a person on a white horse to answer that, but it's actually up to us. So they're a great inspiration and another great example of how Americans are responding to the problem of Citizens United. I want to talk a bit about my book, which is over here. It's a new edition of Corporations Are Not People. I did a brief in the case in Citizens United on behalf of some public interest groups, and it was after I'd left the Attorney General's office, and was speaking in California when apparently there was an editor in the audience who said, this should be a book. So I had a book out called Corporations Are Not People. It was the first edition in about 2011, beginning of 2012. And so people say, well, why do we, or as my friends say, do we have to buy it again? The new edition is just out, September of this year. And I say to my friends and to you, yes, you do have to buy it. If you've already read it, you have to buy it again. And it's not because Nancy and I have three kids in college, although we do. It's because we are giving 100% of the royalties to groups like Regnant Populus and others, Free Speech for People, Move to Amend, all the groups across the country, citizen groups across the country that are doing this work, 100% of the royalties. So that alone isn't the reason you have to buy it, because you might not agree with me. I hope you will after we talk tonight. But the other reason is so much has happened since the first edition. That's why we needed the second edition. It's almost hard to believe, but in just a few years, we didn't have super PACs when I first wrote the book. That was really just was starting and exploded in 2012. The Hobby Lobby case, some of the cases I'll talk more about where corporate rights are just exploding into our public space, a public commons, if you will, public interest. And the phenomenon of the concentrated money in elections, we know so much more now that we could only guess about in 2011. And sadly, our worst guesses, our worst estimates are coming to pass with a vengeance. So that's what I want to talk about tonight. The decision in Citizens United, I think most folks are familiar with. It was in 2010, the Supreme Court struck down the Bipartisan Campaign Reform Act, the so-called McCain-Feingold Act, in particular the provision that had had different manifestations, but basically had been a part of American law for more than a century, the notion that we need to keep corporate and union money from influencing the outcome of an election. So McCain-Feingold said, within 60 days of a federal election, no corporate or union money can be used to directly try to influence specific campaigns, the outcome of an election. Well, that was struck down by the court. And it would have been, I think, a relatively one of the many obscure but complicated campaign finance cases. It did involve a movie about Hillary Clinton. But in the end, and now, those facts don't matter, because what the court did was not really decide that case. It didn't decide, a nonprofit might be able to spend money to advocate or do a movie about a politician running for office. That would have been uncontroversial, I think, no matter which way it came out. What the court did was decide as a matter of requirement under the Constitution that even the most global, the most international, the most powerful corporation in the world, the most money, unlimited money, has to be able to come into our elections, and there's nothing we can do about it. That they said that, as you know, I think that corporations have free speech like people, and money is just like speech, and it's not what the lawyers would describe it as, but that's shorthand. And therefore, the First Amendment prohibits laws like the McCain-Feingold law. So I have a couple of propositions about why that decision has had such a profound effect on us as a nation, and a catastrophic effect. And that's my first proposition, that this we are now way beyond the realm of, well, legal debate, constitutional mistake even maybe, political argument. We are well beyond that to, in my what I would propose for your consideration, a constitutional crisis, a crisis of democracy, a fork in the road where literally we are talking about plutocracy or democracy, and how we respond in these next few years will decide that question. So that sounds like I think some might even say melodramatic way to describe a Supreme Court case. So I want to offer tonight some data for your consideration, some evidence for that proposition. And that part is going to be kind of glum, sorry. The data is not encouraging. The data is depressing. But I have to share it with you. Some of it we know, but some of it we're just beginning to understand. So bear with me through that, because my second proposition is that this is exactly what we needed in America, that this train wreck is actually the beginning of a transformative new citizen engagement, responsible citizen engagement, a change in our political culture that we will see looking back on this. When we get the 28th Amendment that will overturn Citizens United, it will seem as inevitable as the women's right to vote, as electing senators, as some of the other amendments that Andrew mentioned, that we have done this before, we know how to do it as Americans, and we may not want to, we may wish we didn't have to, but we will do it again, and I'll tell you where we are on that process, and I find it encouraging and inspiring, not because of me, but because of what Americans are doing. So I want to share that with you. It's like sharing the good news with you, because it's true, and it's how we win. So, but let me start with the crisis part. So bear with me. I want to dive in a little bit. This last election 2 weeks ago was the most expensive midterm election in history, with the lowest turnout ever since 1942, anyway. So this supposed theory, well, it's just more speech, right? We're all engaged by this great debate we had, right? No, we had $4 billion spent, and more and more Americans decided voting is not a useful activity. Less than one-third, or about one, a little more than one-third of registered voters voted. So think of how few Americans that actually reflects. So I'll talk a bit more about that. But that $4 billion brings the tally since Citizens United to about $30 billion that has been spent on our elections. And I want to, I'll talk more about why I use the word plutocracy, but the starting point is not the amount of money. You know, some would say, well, we spend a lot of money on iPhones or potato chips. You know, it's what Americans have exuberant spending habits. This is all a good thing, just more money, and we must really love politics. No, the problem is that money comes from such a small segment of America. It is such a tiny donor class, and it excludes almost everybody. So I want to show why I think that's the case. So number one, for a while we heard after Citizens United, well, corporations aren't going to spend money. People don't like it, and we don't. Americans. Target spent money publicly on a governor's race in Minnesota, and it led to a national boycott of Target. They apologized. This is early on, you know, right after Citizens United said, we won't do that again. And supposedly the word was, oh, well, Citizens United, it's not going to have that big effect because corporations aren't spending the money because they want to have customers. Well, it's not true. This last election, corporations spent millions and millions of dollars, but they did learn from Target. The trick is not to let us know about it. And so These are global corporations pouring money in, and how do we know this? Well, the Republican Governors Association is one of the vehicles. The Democratic Governors Association is too. The U.S. Chamber of Commerce is. Other so-called 501c4s, these supposedly nonprofit entities, are the fronts for channeling this corporate money in. I said the Republican Governors Association because about 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago now, I suppose just before Election Day, a coder at the Republican National Governors Association miscoded documents that were supposed to be secret so that they ended up on the website. So you could go to the Republican, the RGA as it's called, website, and you saw a list that looked like the Fortune 500 and the millions of dollars that they had put in, partly for access to governors, but also for running into campaigns all over the country. These are not obscure corporations. They're ones all of us know. Walmart, Verizon, Shell, Chrysler, Archer Daniels, Midland, they were all there. Pfizer, many more. And so we know corporations are spending millions of dollars. 40% of the money spent 2 weeks ago, in the election 2 weeks ago, was undisclosed, dark money. We don't know the source, 40%. And this is why. So I don't want to pick on the Republic. This is truly cross-partisan. It's a cross-partisan problem. It'll be a cross-partisan solution. The Democratic Governors Association, I'm confident, would have a similar list. Maybe they have better coders. I don't know. But this is not to pick on one side or the other. But the point is, number one, corporations are concentrations of wealth and power by definition, and could be a good thing in the economic sphere, dangerous in the political sphere. Few of us can call those shots. Very few Americans are able to decide where the corporate money is going to go, but there are a few. Now, what about other ways of participating in what John Boniface, a co-founder of Free Speech for People, calls the wealth primary? It is now a more or less official part of our political system that you show you can get the money before you have any chance of being taken seriously as a candidate. So that's the wealth primary. Where does that money come from and who participates? Almost nobody, actually, in America, believe it or not. I didn't realize this. I participate by making contributions. I'm sure many of you do. But 95% of Americans don't make any contribution politically. Most Americans don't. And why? I think partly, literally, some can't afford it. You know, $50 to a politician when you can't meet the grocery bill is very real for a lot of people. Others, I think, feel like, you know, it's a waste of money. Still more would say it's a waste of money because my small contribution doesn't count, because the real game, as we know, is the big donors. So let's get to them. So 4%+ of all Americans, only 4%, are actually playing the pay-to-play system that we now have at all. 80% of the money, 80%, comes from 0.5% of the population. So almost all the money comes from the so-called large donors, and those large donors constitute far less than 1%. Of the population. Now, that was sort of true before Citizens United. It's much worse now. After Citizens United and the super PAC phenomenon that I mentioned, almost, you know, literally almost everybody is out of the game. Let's look at super PACs. In 2012, we now have data, 2012, 47 donors, that's not like 47%, 47 donors made up more than half of the super PAC money that was spent in 2012, 47. Almost all of it came from about 3,000 donors giving a minimum of $10,000 each. So how many Americans can afford $10,000 to participate in the small club, which is far less than 1%, who are super PAC donors at all? 47 donors make up more than half of it. And here's a number that I think brings it home. 32 super PAC donors gave more money than all the small donors, so-called, 3.7 million of them, to President Obama's campaign and Mitt Romney's campaign combined. So the so-called small donor phenomenon we used to hear about, totally wiped out by 32 donors. you know, the technology is there to be able to send your small contribution and sort of participate in this way, but why would you when 32 donors wipe it out? And that's what's happened now. So one of the donors, the super PAC donors, is Sheldon Adelson. And again, I don't want to pick on anybody. They're on all sides, but I want to, well, pick on Sheldon Adelson because there's good reason to. He gave $100 million to super PACs in 2012, $100 million in the presidential race. Now, he didn't win, but he had a huge amount of influence. And what we're seeing now, and I say he didn't win, he was putting $100 million to, you know, Rick Santorum, Newt Gingrich, people who aren't president, as we know. But it affected the race, and it affected what people said, and it affected what issues we talked about and what we didn't talk about in that race. But now he's back. That's why I'm picking on him. He's got his checkbook out. It wasn't like he's, oh, $100 million, that was a waste of money. No, he thinks it was a great investment. He's back, ready to spend more. And in case you're interested, he's holding auditions for president. There are conferences that he's holding where the candidates, would-be candidates, go, and as he ponders what he's going to do, where his money's going to go in 2016, Molly Ball in the Atlantic magazine attended one of these. She called it the Sheldon Adelson Suck-Up Fest, in which the candidates, and remember, these are our presidential aspirants, the candidates, and again, quoting Molly Ball, like the daughters of King Lear or the cast of Mean Girls, each sought to outdo the others in his fawning of this billionaire. So this is what we've come to. One billionaire can literally almost call the tune that they dance to. And, you know, it's not, I talk about presidential elections, let's look at local elections. Literally, Citizens United is coming home to every American eventually. If it's not there now, it's coming. If you lived in Richmond, California, it's a community of 100,000 people, you would have witnessed Chevron, which has a refinery there, spending $1.3 million on a city council race. $1.3 million through a deceptively named group called Moving Richmond Forward. And if you looked at, well, what's Moving Richmond Forward? It said, their website said, a coalition of first responders, business people and working people and other good citizens of Richmond or something like that. And if you looked at what their budget was, it was $1.3 million, and you've looked at where the money came from, it was a Chevron check for $1.3 million, which then went directly into these attack ads on city council member race in a community of 100,000. They came back in 2014. They spent $3 million. Chevron spent $3 million this time. So if they're doing it on a city council race in a community of 100,000, I guarantee you it's going to happen in school committee. Everything will be affected by this. So that's the heart of the Citizens United money problem, that it is not just the amount of money, it's not just in federal races, it's not just like something that happens in the political sphere that we can ignore. It's affecting our lives, and not just as citizens who wish to participate in a system that we're now excluded from for the most part, but in everything, wages, water we drink, education our kids get, you know, virtually where the jobs are, virtually every aspect of our lives now affected by the distortion and the corruption effect of this kind of concentrated money of the very few. It's why Justice Breyer calls this a crisis of democratic legitimacy. This is a Supreme Court justice saying we have a crisis of democratic legitimacy in our country. And, you know, I think when you look at I say it's on both sides, and it is, our system essentially is becoming red billionaires and millionaires and corporations against blue billionaires and millionaires and corporations. And the people asked to sort of push a lever like American Idol or something, you know. We're spectators instead of citizens. So that's the problem. It's a constitutional problem because it's a constitutional decision, but more importantly, it's a proposition itself. I said I had a couple of propositions for you. Citizens United is a proposition for all of us. It says that economic inequality must now, under our Constitution, be reflected in political inequality, as if it's sort of natural, a natural law almost. It's mandatory that when money is the coin of the realm for our elections and politics, then economic inequality is transferred, as the court intends, to political inequality. I would suggest that goes against the founding principle of our country, that we are created equal. And it doesn't mean we have the same means. It doesn't mean we have the same, obviously we have, there's great inequalities and often will be. But the promise that we had was always politically we are equal. We have equal representation, we have an equal vote, and we have an equal say because politically we believe in the Declaration of Independence promise that we have tried to live out as a country. We are created equal as children of God, if you will, or as human beings, that our rights come because of our humanness and their equal rights. So Citizens United almost literally says, and I'll get to where they literally say it in the McCutcheon case, that's not true. Political equality is not a constitutional value that can support our campaign finance laws. So that's why I use the word plutocracy, and it's not just me. You know, Jim Leach, Iowa Republican, 30 years in Congress, spoke recently in my neck of the woods in Massachusetts and said, "We are Citizens United is pushing us to plutocracy." Bill Moyers, who wrote the foreword to a very fine book I'd recommend you check out, wrote the foreword, says plutocracy. And, you know, I don't mean it, I really don't, as a kind of inflammatory word, or because I want, this is a national conversation we should have, and I try not to use words that are just like people, oh, he's got a strong point of view that's too out there. And I really try to use it with care, but the reason I use it is because I keep hearing it. So I was speaking in Maine about 3 weeks ago now, four weeks ago, and it's central Maine, which I think is actually not that different from Arkansas, central Arkansas. And it, you know, it's down to earth people, a little conservative, you know, not hot headed in one way or the other, but sort of down to earth. And I went to school there, so I kind of know it. My wife's from central Maine, Gardner, Maine. I'll be back there at Thanksgiving next week. I know this area, and it is a kind of conservative, largely rural place. And there's a newspaper called the Kennebec Journal, which comes out of Augusta and Waterville, Maine, up the Kennebec River Valley in Maine. And I was going to speak, and I thought, you know, can I go into this conservative community and throw words like plutocracy around and have a conversation, or will they just think, oh, this guy's too lefty or something? I don't know. So I was thinking about that morning as I got to Waterville, Maine, and I pick up the Kennebec Journal and see what's going on in the area, and I turn to the editorial page. And this is a conservative newspaper. It's been around since the 1800s. And I haven't always agreed with their editorial position, but I read their editorial that day, and here's what it said. This is about 2 weeks before the election. Government, I'm quoting from the editorial, not an op-ed, the editorial. Government cannot be expected to work for the people with this level of campaign spending done by only a few. As income inequality expands, the people who benefit the most from current economic policies are also the ones with outsized influence on those policies. And then the editorial said this, there is a name for government by the rich, plutocracy, and it's not what our founding fathers were trying to create when they guaranteed our freedom of speech. So this is a word that I'm hearing everywhere I go in this country, and it doesn't matter if it's a red state, blue state, conservative. So, and there's a reason. It's people know what the situation is. People know we're being governed by those who have enormous resources. And if you don't know, you know, we can read the political scientists who unfortunately are confirming this fact. You may have heard about the study by Martin Gillens and Benjamin Page, Princeton and Northwestern. And they released a study of probably the most comprehensive study of a large data set about the influence and who influences and how policy is actually made in America. And they call it the influence of affluence. Here's their conclusion. The estimated impact of average citizens' preferences is at a non-significant near zero level. Ordinary citizens have little or no independent influence on policy. That is their conclusion. And they conclude, economic elites and organized groups representing business interests have substantial independent impacts on U.S. government policy. So We got the data, we got the gut feeling. We know that this is a serious case of not just a legal decision gone wrong, but plutocracy versus democracy. But if the Manhattan Institute, a well-funded institute, says, don't worry, this is their response to the Benjamin Page, Martin Gillen's Influence of Affluence study, rich people are better informed, vote more often, and represent the views of the middle class anyway. So there's, you know, don't worry about the problem that ordinary people don't have influence. And I said the Supreme Court agrees with this theory. The McCutcheon case is one of the series of cases that I think people mean when they say Citizens United. It's not just that, it's a series of cases. The McCutcheon case struck down a longstanding federal law that had actually been affirmed before in the Buckley case, struck down the aggregate limits, the so-called total limit that you can give to federal candidates across the country. It was at $123,000. It was struck down because a coal engineering firm CEO named Sean McCutcheon said that violated his First Amendment rights under the Free Speech Clause. So you are now liberated. I know you've been waiting. You had to stop at $123,000. You can now write into the millions of dollars to checks across the country now that our Constitution has been restored. But in the McCutcheon case, I want to read to you from the brief the winning argument. This is the winning argument from the McCutcheon brief. Contribution limits may not be upheld as a means of limiting disparities in the extent to which people of different economic backgrounds are able to participate in the political process. I mean, think about that. That is a exactly correct statement of the Supreme Court law, which is why it won. The Supreme Court agrees with that proposition, which is to say, again, I almost don't need to, a lawyer's job is sometimes to translate legalese. There's not much legalese in there. It's that if economic disparities prevent people from participating in the political process, we're not allowed to do anything about it. That would violate the so-called free speech rights of money and corporations. So for those of you who can't participate, for those of you who don't have millions of dollars to write checks, too bad. The Constitution says, according to McCutcheon and the Supreme Court, we're not allowed to solve that problem. So this, in my view, is, and not just my view, is how republics fail. That's why I say this is an emergency. This is a crisis. This is an existential question of American democracy. If we keep going down this road, we're only 3 or 4 years in. It only gets worse from here. And I hate to say it, the good news is coming, bear with me, but there's more bad news. Remember, this is not just about money in politics, it's not just about campaign finance. The court has created a new phenomenon, constitutional rights for corporate entities, no matter what their size. So we at Free Speech for People, in addition to the amendment work you'll hear more about, have a legal work program. We have a national advisory board of law professors and lawyers, two state Supreme Court justices, have joined our board. We are doing cases. We're no longer giving a free pass. We're going to be in these cases across the country. Let me just tell you, to illustrate what I call the corporate veto that is striking down laws at an accelerating rate since Citizens United that are in the public interest but might affect a corporation's bottom line. In St. Louis, we're in a case where 30,000 St. Louis residents voted or wanted to vote. They didn't get to vote. They signed a ballot initiative, which they were allowed to do, putting on the municipal ballot in St. Louis a question about whether their tax dollars, tax subsidies, would continue to be extracted and given to Peabody Energy, which is based in St. Louis. They had a plan to let's have a more resilient economy and have our tax dollars increase, support the schools, build roads, build the infrastructure for a longer-term, better economy. Well, they didn't get to vote. They were sued. It was blocked, a theory of corporations having free speech rights and equal protection rights to have that tax subsidy, that it would somehow violate poor Peabody Energy's constitutional rights if they were no longer able to get your tax dollars. That would have been bad enough. They also got out of the Missouri legislature in the space of about 2 weeks a law that only applied to St. Louis, only to coal companies, that said that is outside the bounds of a municipal ballot. So it was basically a two, influence in the legislature plus the corporate veto in the courts the case goes on, but there's been no vote. It's been blocked so far. Another case, St. Louis, or Seattle, you may have heard about, had a ballot initiative to raise the minimum wage in Seattle to $15 an hour. That's not a lot of money, as you know. It's not like, oh, now we can sit around the pool. We got 15 bucks an hour, but it's a big jump. So they phased it in over time. Well, corporations filed a lawsuit saying that the minimum wage violates corporate constitutional rights. So I think this is the first time since the last Gilded Age where this used to happen. We've been here before. The last Gilded Age, the Supreme Court struck down the minimum wage in the so-called Lochner era in the early 1900s, late 1800s, struck down child labor laws. Literally, child labor got struck down as a violation. So we've been here before, and we're now going back if we don't do something about it. So I could go on, food laws under attack, you know, energy laws, you name it, almost every area of the public interest is no longer able to function because our democracy isn't able to make policy decisions, and the courts are striking down even the minimal laws we get. So what do we do? I think we recognize, number one, the stakes. The stakes aren't just like the data, it's also the dynamic, a vicious circle of more money from fewer people, having a more dispiriting effect on most people, people checking out, that's why we had almost no one voting last time, and that's not irrational in this kind of system, but it's a vicious circle, a sort of systems theory of how republics fail and how democracy dies. So I think, though, and now I hope, I see so many sad faces, I'm sorry. I'm sad, too, because this is our birthright that's at stake here. But we can do something about it. And I believe, and I'm seeing, and I want to share with you, and the book has all the stories of how this is happening. We are not only stopping that vicious circle, we're actually creating a whole new circle, almost outside of this corrupted system, which is a virtuous circle, where people are doing things like constitutional amendment resolutions, like these folks are doing, and bringing people back in to work with people who might not agree with them. And they win a resolution at the local level or the state level, and they say, it's like flexing a democracy muscle, it's working. And it spreads, and people come back in. And it's not like with a naive, oh, we're gonna have a 28th Amendment tomorrow if we do this and all will be well. No, it's like a grim determination not to go down, to stand for what we believe as a country, and to do this hard work. So let me tell you quickly where we are on the constitutional amendment, which is a big lift. I won't lie to you. It's, you know, if the stakes weren't so high, it would be nice not to have to do it. But we need a 28th Amendment for a lot of reasons. Number one is we can't live with Citizens United, and that's why seven Supreme Court decisions, as Andrew said, were overturned, because this has happened before, from Dred Scott to the court ruling women had no right to vote, to say the court ruling that men and women could, or men especially, could be drafted and go to Vietnam, but the 18, 19, 20-year-olds didn't have a right to vote. Lots of times the court gets it wrong, and it galvanizes us to do probably what's overdue. We should have started earlier, but the court says something that we know in our hearts and souls is wrong, and it will have consequences for our country, and we get to work. And that's what's happening now. So we need 2/3 of Congress eventually. I was talking to some of the students. They rightly have some questions. Congress can't agree on when to have lunch. How are they gonna have 2/3 of Congress get this out of the Congress? And I'll tell you how. We're gonna keep doing what we're doing. So what have we done so far? 16 states have enacted 28th Amendment resolutions telling their Congress delegation, get behind the 28th Amendment. 16 states, 600 cities and towns. You could do it right here in Little Rock if you wanted. 600 cities and towns have called people together, debated the issue, got a city council, or often a ballot initiative in the city or town to condemn Citizens United and call for the 28th Amendment. 200 of those 600 were by ballot initiative. Not one has failed. Not one has been close. Every town, red state, blue state, 75% plus want to do this. So we can do this, and we are doing it. And so I want to talk about Montana for just a second, because two of the states of those 16 states were ballot initiative states, Montana and Colorado. And Montana was in 2012, and as you may recall, Montana in 2012 easily voted for Mitt Romney. He of corporations are people, my friend, by 10 points. It wasn't close. We had on the ballot that same day a very detailed, clear ballot initiative that explained, that said the policy of Montanans is, and when I say we, I mean it's a big group and a lot of local folks in Montana that did this, but said the policy of Montana is that we want a political level playing field, that we are politically equal, that money isn't speech, and that corporations are not people under the Constitution. We as people have a right and a duty to make the rules for corporations, not the other way around. I'm paraphrasing. And it instructed, I guess, you know, you folks out here, we don't have the guts, I suppose, to do this in New England. We just demand or ask. But Montana, they instructed their federal delegation to get the 28th, get behind the 28th Amendment, get it out to the states for ratification. So that was on the ballot in 2012. And what happened? Well, ranchers, business people, working people, religious leaders like Bishop Judith Crist, who wrote op-eds for Montana Lutheran Evangelical Church. The Evangelical Church wrote op-eds around the state saying corporations are not created in the image of God. This is not a partisan issue. It's a faith issue. It's a justice issue. Montanans came together. We had a Republican lieutenant governor and a Democratic governor standing together saying, on a video, saying, Citizens United must go. We need a 28th Amendment. We don't agree on much, but we agree on this. So what happened? The same day they voted for Mitt Romney, 75%, 25% passed this ballot initiative. John Tester, the senator from Montana, promptly joined the 28th Amendment in Congress, the Democracy for All Amendment, and we had a vote in September on that. People say, well, Congress doesn't vote anymore. They almost don't, but there was a vote. We did something people said would never happen. We cleared the Senate Judiciary Committee, got to the floor of the Senate, had a good debate, and we won, in one sense, 54 to 42. So we clearly have more work to do because we'll need 67 eventually. But the game is not in Washington. The game is right in home. It's right with us. It's in our cities and towns and communities and states. And because what's at stake is not a political, you know, partisan fight, and we just get enough votes. What's at stake is like who we are as a country, who we are as citizens, and we win that debate every time we have it. I think you'll agree, most people are with us on this, and if we can come together and do this cross-partisan work, 75% means people are working together who don't agree. This defies the conventional wisdom that we're too divided as a country, that people don't have what it takes anymore. Well, we do have what it takes. This is the 28th Amendment, not the first. We've done this before. And you know, we'll keep doing it again. Those 600 cities and towns, 40 of them were 2 weeks ago on Tuesday, a day that, you know, it didn't get any news, but 40 communities in six states passed constitutional amendment resolutions. And I congratulate you. I think the country's noticed issue 3, which passed here in Arkansas. And you know, I wouldn't venture an opinion on the details of it, but if you get ethics and anti-corruption and big money, a response to big money on the ballot, I think it wins in any state, anywhere in the country. So we can do this, and we will. And I will just close with a bit of history for me that I know you know too, but I take faith in our history as a country because we've been through hard times. We've been through existential crises of democracy. I took a run along the river and looked at the Civil War memorial you have down there and the story of Arkansas and the Civil War. We've been through horrible things in this country that democracy easily could have died and come out the other side. And so I think of Abraham Lincoln in those days, 1862, when it truly was on the line again, and he called for the 13th Amendment then. It was a year before the Emancipation Proclamation. He called for the 13th Amendment, and he said something that I think a lot about and would offer for your consideration too, because he knew, you know, this was challenging forces of injustice and power and money, and it was transforming a system that was wrong, but it was so ingrained, but he said we had to do it. And here's what he said. He said, it's not can any of us imagine better. Remember, the 13th Amendment, of course, abolished slavery. So he called for that and says, it's not can any of us imagine better, but can we all do better? It is not enough to think anew. We must act anew. Lincoln said, we must disenthrall ourselves, and then we shall save our country. And, of course, we did. But I think we're in similar circumstances, and we have since then. Remember, that was the 13th Amendment. We've done 14 of them since then. So although it's hard, we are thinking anew. We are acting anew. We are not only imagining better and being content to, well, let's hope it gets there. We're doing better. We're doing this. And I think we're disenthralling ourselves. You know, we're no longer thinking, well, if we just vote for the right candidate, all will be well. I think we're recognizing we have a crisis of democracy, and the solution lies within us, and we have to act better, do better, come together, and we will save our country. So now it's our turn. I'm confident we'll do it. I look forward to working with all of you and folks across the country so that someday we'll look back and say we did our thing in our generation, just as Americans did before us, to save our country when the chips were down. And I think of Winston Churchill, who said, Americans always do the right thing after exhausting all the other possibilities. So we've exhausted the possibilities. Let's do the right thing. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Jeff. Good job. Now that you raised Amendment 3, I think we should acknowledge that one of the authors of that amendment is here tonight, Representative Warrick Sabin, and this is his birthday. So you've given him a great birthday, but Representative Sabin.
Happy birthday, and thank you.
And the former head of Common Cause in Arkansas, Scott Trotter's here, and on December 8th, which I just verified that date, Scott, Warrick, Representative John Woods, the other co-author, Representative Sabin, Scott Trotter, and Randy Zook with the Arkansas State Chamber, going to be here for a panel hosted by the Clinton School and Political Animals to talk about Amendment 3 and its implications. So that'll be the first big major public discussion of that amendment. So thank you guys for participating. Here's the question. It's a hard one for me to ask. But the people on the left seem to demonize people on the right in terms of money and in terms of richness and in terms of that all the money is pouring in from the right. But when you looked at these last campaigns, there were lots of big donors and underground PACs or whatever you call those places that come from the left. I mean, isn't the left a little hypocritical on this issue?
No. There's a longer and more complicated answer, but no, I don't think either side is hypocritical, and I don't personally, and I know we at Free Speech for People don't believe that the problem is only on the right. Not at all. I think the problem is a system problem that both right and left are using, and we often will talk and try very hard to talk about, you know, I picked on Sheldon Adelson, I could have added Tom Steyer, you know, these are people who I believe in good faith have strong views and lots of money, so they're using them, and there's nothing wrong with that under Citizens United, they're allowed to, and there's nothing wrong with strong views, it's what we're all about, but systemically we have to change it in my view, and we have to not demonize because there's no solution that gets us there if we're demonizing. The only thing that will save us, in my view, is actually coming together, right and left, as we did in Montana and elsewhere, to work together to accept, okay, we can all play this game, you know, that's why I said red billionaires versus blue billionaires, or we can try to save our country.
Well, as Representative Sabin and Republican Representative John Woods did, they proved that you could get something passed. Okay. I'm not sure I agree with you on whether, but you have your opinion and I have mine, and that's the great thing about a university. All right, Maddie.
Hi, my name's Maddie. I'm a Clinton School student. Thank you so much for being here. One thing I just wanted to ask you about has to do with the fact that energy companies are playing a huge role. You've mentioned some of them, McCutcheon. The situation in California as well as in St. Louis has all been energy corporations playing a role in this. And if you're paying attention to energy and environmental issues, we have a shortening timeline there in dealing with lots of problems. Paying attention to the UN or the IPCC, these are quickly approaching issues. So I'm curious what timeline you're looking at for dealing with this and how that may or may not fit with other timelines also going on.
Yeah, thank you. Great question, and I quite agree with the premise of the question. My book talks a lot about the problem of a fossil-fueled, money-dominated system. You know, a CEO of a coal company, Don Blankenship, just got indicted in West Virginia, killed 29 men in a coal mine explosion that never should have happened. Massey Energy had 65,000 violations of the Mine Safety Act, and the report, the independent report of the governor that was appointed, an independent commission, concluded the reason those men died was because of political corruption of money, power of the coal company. That's a dramatic example. The macro example you mentioned is a rapidly accelerating crisis and catastrophe on the environmental side. And so the timeline is urgent, like all of our timelines. But I don't think we get there unless we take on something that might seem long-term, like the amendment, and I think it'll happen faster than we can guess. Remember, when I first wrote the edition of the first book, one state had passed a resolution. 36 months later, 16 states, right? It's 36 months, we've had 16 states pass this. We had that vote in Congress, 55. We had two senators willing to talk to us about an amendment just 36 months ago when the first edition came out. So I think, you know, it's not linear change. It's like the climate and other things. It's a systems change where we are nearing a tipping point, not only for the bad things, but also for the good things. So it's not the only answer that's the cure-all, but it's the process of re-engaging Americans to take ownership of these issues. And I don't think we can solve any of our issues if we don't solve the money issue and the power, the premise of the fossil fuel companies and others that are blocking any effort at rational policy discourse right now.
You brought up the 13th Amendment, and I think that's a great example for why it's tough to become anything other than cynical with this. The 13th Amendment, as we all know, outlawed slavery, except under the instance of incarceration, but prisons being traded on the New York Stock Exchange, it just gave you slavery in a different way. Jim Crow codified poverty as blackness, and then you had new slaves. So with that, the question becomes, when we get away from the platitudes, what then makes the direction different in the United States with the hegemonic control of Democrats and Republicans against and compared against, say, a Russia, where you overtly have oligarchy?
Well, there's a lot packed into that question. My stab at it is I don't think this is actually platitudes, but I don't think it's an easy, if we just do this, all will be well, either. We also had the 14th Amendment and the 15th Amendment that were supposed to guarantee equality and the right to vote, and 100 years later, of course, we're still struggling and people dying to fulfill that promise. But it's the necessary step. Because if we lose this battle, which is a constitutional battle right now, do we mean it when we say we're all created equal? Does political equality actually count? And if we don't respond to that, we don't even begin to start the long road to a closer approximation of the vision that I think we all believe in as Americans. It's never at an end. It's always a process of trying to fulfill a promise. But this is, I think, an essential step. So I don't offer it as the solution, and I honestly don't offer it as, well, then Democrats and Republicans will be better and will be better. I actually think, and we have amendment moments, the 13th, 14th, and 15th are one. We've never just passed one amendment. I mean, we've often used Article 5 in the amendment process, but almost always they've come in bunches. So the progressive era, the last turn of the century, they had four amendments in 10 years. People forget, 1961 to 1971, older folks like me, it's our lifetimes, we did four amendments in 10 years. And three of them involved democracy, representation of D.C. folks. Not all the way. They should have a right to vote, too. But they had representation in Congress for people in District of Columbia. The poll tax, remember, the Supreme Court said the poll tax is constitutional. It was being used to block people from voting. A constitutional amendment overturned the poll tax. Now, again, that doesn't mean all is well, but if we don't take these moments, and 18, 19, and 20-year-olds is the other big one, having a right to vote. So I think we can create an amendment moment, and when we have those amendment moments historically, we do a big advance where it's not just the amendments, it's a wave of overdue reforms across the spectrum. Does that get us to nirvana? No. It gets us to be trying to fulfill our promise as a democracy, and we'll all have hard work to do still. So.
Sadly, by the way, Arkansas never voted to ratify an amendment.
Right?
Yeah,
right.
We eliminated the state poll tax, but we never have voted. It's still one of the few states that's
really?
Never done it. Yes.
My name is Byron Thomas.
Hi.
What does the language of a 28th Amendment sound like, and what guarantee do we have as citizens that some group like an ALEC won't be crafting this language?
Yeah, no guarantee. That's why we have to be vigilant and work hard. We had part of the energy of this movement is why we had 14 different amendment bills in Congress. Suddenly, all the Congress people wanted their own amendment because they knew this is what Americans want. And so we had 14, but when we had the vote in the Senate, it was the Democracy for All Amendment. People got behind this language. So I'll just read it to you. And I can promise you it wasn't ALEC that wrote it, because I was on some of the phone calls and we helped to write this, and it's not perfect, and it's not necessarily the amendment that'll win in the end, but we thought it was very good. Our allies thought it was good. We worked with the Judiciary Committee, and this is what won 54 votes that day. It's called the Democracy for All Amendment. I think it's quicker if I just read it. Section 1, to advance democratic self-government and political equality and to protect the integrity of government and the electoral process, Congress and the states may regulate and set reasonable limits on the raising and spending of money by candidates and others to influence elections. Section 2, Congress and the states shall have power to implement and enforce this article by appropriate legislation and may distinguish between natural persons and corporations or other artificial entities created by law, including by prohibiting such entities from spending money to influence elections. Section 3, I don't think it's necessary, but folks wanted it. Nothing in this article shall be construed to grant Congress or the states the power to abridge the freedom of press. I say I don't think it's necessary, not because I don't believe in freedom of press, but because it doesn't abridge freedom of the press. It's not intended to. But just to make sure, Section 3 just says it doesn't abridge freedom of the press. So that's the language. As I said, there are other amendment ideas. There's the People's Rights Amendment, which says corporations, I'm paraphrasing, but corporations don't have constitutional rights, that we the people have the power and the authority to make the rules for corporations. So this will be a process to get the right language, and I do think we have to be vigilant, be part of that process to make sure we get good language, but I think that was pretty good.
Do you have a question back there, Bob? I thought I saw a hand up. Okay, yes, here's a question right here.
I grew up saying that I wanted to be a politician and eventually run for president. And then I went to Lyon College, and they brought in a representative who was running, who spoke honestly with us about these details, like the amount of money you have to get to even be considered by either side as a potential candidate. And I became incredibly disheartened amongst multiple issues, that and then the religious component of it as well. So what can you say for people like me who kind of end up losing faith that there's even a point in trying at these days?
Yeah, well, don't give up, number one. I hope you will be president someday. But that's exactly, think of the talent we are missing in our governments, because so many good people don't want anything to do with it or can't. They don't have the donors. They don't have the relationships that bring millions of dollars to a campaign. That's the wealth primary, people like you. People, like a lot of people, are excluded and not even bothering to try. That's the problem. That's very dangerous, and for our country, as well as personally, for millions of lives who could have made a big difference for us. So that, I think, number one, I would say, don't accept that as the reality, right? I mean, that is the reality that we all are living with, but So what do we do? Well, you can be a leader. You want to be president? Do something even bigger. Win the 28th Amendment. Presidents come and go. Amendments are in there for good. Be historic. Overturn the system that blocked you out. Say it's wrong. Say that you are politically equal. And work to help mobilize people in your generation to say, we're not just going to go away. We are going to run for president someday, and we're not going to go begging and borrowing to rich people and corporations. We're going to run on the issues because we're going to help create a system that enables that. So I say, don't give up, you know. Do this historic work, and I'd be happy to talk more offline or send me an email.
Yes, and you can talk more when he signs this book. speaking of hawking, corporations are not people. Jeff's going to sign it. You all can come over and ask any additional questions. I know there's more. Obviously, a great interest in this topic. Let's thank Jeff for coming to the Clinton School.
Thank you very much.